My name is Belén Albeza. I work at Mozilla. This talk is going to be about HTML5 development with Facebook. So this is my Twitter handle, Belén Albeza. I just created the URL for the repository of this talk and some sample source codes, so you can check it out later. So a bit about myself. This is actually kind of like my alter ego. I run a commit stream. This one, Natasha, would love probably. I'm a developer, and I've worked in the game industry in the past, and I'm more focused on web development for some years. So I have this kind of mixed background between web development and game development. So of course I would be interested in HTML5 game development as well. And this is what I'm doing at Mozilla. I'm trying to find ways to let people know, okay, this is the API that you can use to make cool games. So why make HTML5 games? Well, this is probably like a silly question, because we can. I know this sounds obvious, but like 10 years ago, we wouldn't be able to do these things. Nowadays, we have APIs that we can have WebGL rendering. We can have gamepad input. We have a web audio API that is really good to totally code your own synthesizer or to create sounds, whatever. So we have all these technologies that we can use to make games, so why don't we do it? This is the library that we're going to see. It's a favorite, you know, two-day game development framework out there. It is open source, has excellent documentation, lots of examples. The website is special type. And you should check it out. I mean, it's really awesome, this one. Why Facer? Okay? These are some games that I created with Facer. These were done for Lubum Dare, which is a game development competition. In this competition, you have to create a game in 48 hours on your own. I mean, you cannot have a team. And you have to create everything from scratch, with audio assets, graphics, code, in a weekend, right? So when you are participating in this competition, it is important to use a technology that will allow you to do, like, you know, fast development. That's what I do these games with JavaScript and Facer. And you're going to see some sample. This game is called Metal vs. Hipster. We didn't solve it, so sorry about that. I like the graphics better in this game, so this is the one that I showed around. So, come on, the sound. That this is all your fault. Okay, it has full sound. It worked before. But basically, you control this character who has a guitar on friends. And there are flying muffins and hisses around, you have to keep them all. It's a game, very simple. But I really like it. Also ported it to mobile, it works on mobile as well, so it's kind of fun. It has kind of like, this one is like a space shooter, and this one is a battle one. So basically it's not limited to just one genre, like some tools like, I don't know, RPG Maker or anything. So you can do it kind of to the game. So, this is the URL of the slide and the example. So the way that this talk is going to work is that since we have just half an hour, I will be introducing like generic game development concepts like sprites or, you know, a physics engine, and then, you know, which is the API of Facer that we need to call, right? If you take a look at the examples, you will be able to get all the details of the full implementation of that technique. But the cool thing about this talk is that even if you are not interested in Facer, this applies to any other framework or any other technology, whether you're using, I don't know, Unity or again in C++, in HTML, the techniques that we're going to see are quite common to, you know, regular game development. So let's start. What do we need to make a game? Here are some components. We're going to see some of them. We need to, you know, render images. We need to load, you know, several types of assets. We need to get the player's input somehow, like the gamepad or keyboard presence. We are going to need some of these components that are sprites, the sims, you know, artificial intelligence, physics, whatever. So the first thing that we need is this thing called the game loop or the main loop. You know, every single game could be like 2 or 3 has this thing going on, which is we have an initial phase that we can load and set up our world or our game. So in the load phase, we load all the assets, right? that we are going to need, like the images, the audio files, the fonts, and then on the setup, what we do is to, maybe we are instantiating like a whole level, so okay, this is the level map, you are spawning the enemies, you are spawning the main character, and we set it up so that the game can actually start. So once this initial phase is done, we start the game loop, which is this thing. We have two phases. First one is update, and in this phase we update the game logic, the current status of the game, and also get the player's input. So we will get, okay, if the left key pressed, then I will update the, you know, the hero position, and we move it to the left. And after this update phase has finished, we render the game code. And we have this loop going on, ideally, you know, 60 times per second, so we can have 60 frames per second, which is what nobody's players expect. If we cannot reach 60 frames per second, we can, you know, settle for 30. But below 30, you will start to see, like, actually, you know, really bad, the animations will jump, so it will not look okay. So try to aim above 30 frames per second. How we are doing this loop in Phaser? We create this loop at the moment that we initialize Phaser. So in order to initialize Phaser, we need to set up some parameters. So basically the idea is that in Phaser we can create like a web gear or canvas to be canvas, a canvas to be context. What we are doing is in this initialization, we are passing callbacks for these steps that we have in the game loop. So we provide a canvas for render, a canvas for update, and so on. So this is how it works. We have this object here, and this object has like these functions. The name is important because Phaser we look for this name. So preload is the phase where we load all assets, create, we set up our game world, so we create the enemies, create the current level, whatever, and then we have a data render that will be called automatically. So we don't have to actually implement this loop. Phaser will call these functions whenever they need to happen or be executed. So here we are just, the way that we initialize Phaser is just creating a new instance of Phaser game. We provide our game size, so it's like a standard, no, 640x480. Then we can choose the type of context that we want, whether it's WebGL or canvas. This is the wrapper. This is a string, that is the ID of an element that this canvas will be attached to. And then loop is the object that we created with the callbacks. And we are done. With that, we have a game loop running. So okay, we have a game loop. How do we draw images with? Because they are like one of the most basic things that a game has. Okay, we need to load the asset. And the way the asset manager works in Phaser is that we assign a key to it. This is a tweet. And then we can refer later to this image by using that key. So what we do is to, okay, we load the asset, and then we create a image entity. It gets added to the game world, and then we say, okay, image entity, use this asset and this coordinate. So this is what we're doing here. In the preload phase, we load the asset. Here we are assigning the background string to it as the key. We provide the path. And then on create, which is the part where we set up our game world, okay, let's create a new image entity. This is done with a factory function here, that is game.add.image. We provide the coordinates and the key for the asset. So what this will do is to, okay, an image will belong to your game world at coordinates 0, 0, will refer to this asset, and since it belongs to the game world, because it has been created with this factory method, you will get rendered automatically every frame without us having to actually call image.render. But images are not that common in games. Well, they are, but what we have instead is like a more like complicated or complex entity that is called sprites. So the way I like to think of sprites is like images in movement. So this is a classic game, Sonic. So in this picture, the whole background will be maybe like a Phaser image instance, but here we have some things that can move around. There is Sonic, the main character, we have an enemy, we have the rings that Sonic can pick up, so this will be a sprite. So why do we need this kind of like more complex entity? Because sprites have behavior, right? Sprites can interact with each other, depending on the engine or framework, they have something like more possibilities in regards to rendering. So usually can change the transparency, the rotation, they can have animation as well. So this is all handled in Pacer with this class, that is Pacer Sprite. So there are two ways to create sprites. So this one below, that is game as a sprite, is very similar to the code that we use to create image. We create a Pacer Sprite entity, we'll add it to the game world. And this line is equivalent to these two ones here, that is, we manually instantiate with new an instance of the sprite, and then we can manually add it to the world, so it gets rendered and updated every frame. So why we would want to do this instead of just this one? Because usually we want to extend the sprite class with around. So for instance, it can have, if the main character is like a spaceship, maybe it can have a method that is shoot, right? So I would create my own, you know, ship class with the method shoot, and then this will extend this sprite. And if you have a custom class for the sprites, you need to use this way to instantiate it and add it to the world. So once we have the sprite in our world, we can tweak the properties like the angle or rotation, the transparency, the aimbot point, etc. So sprites can have animations. There are two ways of doing animations in 3D games. One is based on bones. You are seeing, well, you probably all have seen like soft pad. It's that kind of animation that the image is fixed and then you use like bones or mathematical functions to rotate the bits and it's animated, similar to class animation as well. But this is the classical one, which is the one that faces supports out of the box, which is every frame of the animation is actually a separate picture. So this is, if you're familiar with CSS sprites, this is where that technique got the name from game development. It's like, okay, instead of having like, you know, multiple single pictures of an animation, let's put the whole animation rendered in a single picture. And we will choose like, we will flip the image and we will render the different parts depending on which part of the animation we are in. So this is done in Pacer, the same thing. It's like, okay, we need to load the asset. So instead of doing like game load image, we are loading a sprite set. It's the same thing. We assign a key, we provide the path. The only thing that we need to do is to provide, okay, and every frame of the animation, this is the width and the height. So Pacer can know, okay, where to speed the picture. And then in create, we create our sprite as usual. We add the animation. Here, I just put like one parameter that is an arbitrary name that I'm going to use. And if we just say this parameter, the animation will take the whole picture. But we can say, okay, this is the jump animation that goes from frame 5 to 7. We can do that as well. And then to play an animation, we just need to refer to it. We put like the name of the sprite, dot animation, dot play. And this is the animation that you are going to play with this speed. And the last parameter is a flag, so we can have a loop. So we can have infinite animations as well. If we would like to stop the animation, we just call a method that is stop. So this is very easy to use. We don't need to manually keep track of the time, which is something that you need to use usually in this kind of, you know, libraries. So this is really useful to get animation in our games. So okay, we have images, we have sprites, we can animate the sprites, but how do we move them around? There are two ways of doing this. One is the old school version, which is this one that I'm going to show, and the other one is using Species Engine that we're going to see later. So the old school version is just to manually update the sprite position every frame, depending on the subject. So you usually use Newton's equation for that. But these equations require time, like this variable. So in game development, we have this concept that is the delta time, which is the time that has passed between the current frame and the previous one. And this is called delta. So in Pacer, the delta time is actually stored in this kind of variable that is game.time.elapsed. It's in milliseconds. I like to work with seconds, so that's why I'm dividing it by 1,000, but it's not necessary. And here I'm using just like a simple equation. The Newton one to actually update the, you know, the sprite position depending on the speed. And this is super fast. This is how games have been done since forever. So, I mean, if your game is not complicated, you probably want to use this approach. So, we see you know, how to do scribe, how to move them, you know, how to create images. So images and scribe are kind of like entities. I know this is like a very abstract word, but we'll go with this. So these entities live in our game world, and this game world is represented in this screen, which is the game screen. Most frameworks or engines have this kind of structure. If your framework doesn't, you need to implement it because it's really handy. It's really handy. So in the game that I showed you before, the Metal vs. Sisters, this will be like a representation of this tree. So we have a text that is called okay, wave number one, that was on the top left corner, I think. Text in page and entities. So we have an entity that is the main character, that is a sprite. This sprite has some children, which is another sprite that is the guitar, and then a particle system that generates the fire of the flames. And then we have another entity that is called group, that we will see later, but this is basically like a list of sprites. So I have a group for all the enemies, for the muffins and the history. So what's the deal with this tree? So it's basically like a data structure to store the game entities. So everything that belongs to this tree gets updated and rendered automatically at the frame. And it has a hierarchy because it's a tree. So this is really useful because we have, for instance, the main character has two children. What you usually do with this is like, okay, all the coordinates and maybe like graphic properties are relative to the parent. So what happens is that, okay, if the game character moves, then the children will move automatically as well, if they do have to actually update the position manually. That's why when the main character is moving, the guitar and the flames actually follow the character. So people look like they are like separate sprites, but they actually are. So how do we use this tree to create and destroy sprites? Which is something that we want in our game, for example, we want to have, okay, when you know the player's bullet, you know, collides with an enemy, we want to destroy the enemy and maybe the wood. So we just need to add them or remove them from this tree. The problem is that it's expensive. I mean, doing a new in any language. I mean, this is not like a JavaScript problem, it's like a generic problem to every language. I mean, allocating memory is expensive, and releasing memory is expensive, especially if there is a garbage collector involved. So how do you minimize this thing? You recycle sprites using sprite tools. So this tool is like basically, it can be like an array or a linked list, whatever you want, and you will put your sprites on it. And whenever you need to delete or remove an sprite, instead of doing a delete or free or, you know, replacing the reference, what you do is to put a flag, like a property on that sprite, that marks then as a zombie sprite. So your game tree, what it will do is like, okay, I'm in the render phase. If this sprite a zombie, if it is, it doesn't exist, so I will skip it. So sprites that are marked as zombies don't get rendered, don't get updated, they don't take part of, you know, physics checks, because they don't exist. They just exist in the memory, but they don't exist in a world, even though they are on the truth. Yeah. So in basically this kind of flag is called exists, which is, you know, pretty obvious. So the way that this does is that, okay, whenever I need to create an sprite, I will ask this structure, okay, is there a zombie I can reuse? If there isn't, I do a new and add the sprite to this list. If there is a zombie, what it will do is like, okay, I will set the flag to you're not a zombie anymore, I will reset the sprite properties, I will call the constructor, let's say, again, and then you have a brand new sprite in your world without having to do a new. And this is really useful. In Phaser, since this is like something that is very common to all games, whether you have been in your game in C++ or in JavaScript, doesn't matter. Phaser has this thing implemented that is Phaser group, which is a list of sprites, and you can use to handle these tools and also to check collisions between, okay, you know, if you put the bullets, for instance, in one group, you can check collisions between, okay, the bullet group and the enemy's group. Another thing that we need to get again is input. In HTML5, we have APIs to get info from, you know, touch events, from the keyboard, from the mouse, for gamepads, for analogic joysticks, for I don't know, the sensors in your phone, like the accelerometers. We can use all these controls to make games. So the only thing to keep that on is that sometimes these controls, the browsers have some action associated with them. So for instance, if you press the space bar, most browsers do like a scroll down the page. So what you need is to capture this event to prevent the bubbling up, so the browser doesn't know that the space bar has to be pressed because you are using it in your game. So this is an example of using like keyboard input interfacer. Here we are creating a key by using like, okay, keyboard, keyboard, a key. We pass a tico, which is a number. Facer has constant for all the keys that the keyboard has. So here we are creating a key that is associated with the space bar. And using a key capture, we prevent the bubbling. So once we have this space bar key, we can do things like subscribing to events. So here, space bar on down, this will be mapped to the browser event that is on key down. And we have for all the events like OK or whatever. And besides checking for events, we can actually, there is a flag that we can check every frame, and it will be set to create the key express. So depending on the action, you know, we sometimes need to use the event, or sometimes we just need to check this flag. And it is that easy, I mean, it's not really complicated. Regardless to audio, it's very similar to pictures. We can load and play, you know, the same audio format that the HTML5 audio tag has. And the API is the same as images. I mean, we load the audio, assigning a key, the add it to the game world, and once we have this instance, we can play it, stop it, we can actually play a segment of it, we can control the volume, so maybe the left speaker has more volume than the right speaker, so we can all do this sort of thing. Text. I mean, most games require some form of text rendering, even if it's just to render the player's score. So, Facer supports both CSS fonts and bitmap fonts. Most of the time I use CSS fonts, that's the example I took it here. And the API for this is the same as Pixie, which is the library that Facer uses in the inside. So, again, text is an entity, so we use the factory method to create it. You look at the coordinates, the actual text string, and then some styling properties. This is the part that is similar to Pixie API. And then the text object has some methods assigned, so we can update the actual string, or we can set the visibility to false if you want. So how do we handle pieces and collisions? Because this is something that, maybe not pieces, but collisions we need on every game. So this is the old school method. Again, most games in the past use this technique because it's super fast. It's not accurate, but it works well enough that most people use it. I use it all the time. So basically, it consists of, by checking if one sprite overlaps another sprite, so you surround the sprites by a simple geometric figure. Most of the time it's rectangles or circles. Because we have tested when, okay, is this rectangle overlapping this rectangle? It's a matter of doing like a sum. I mean, you don't need to do trigonometry things or, you know, crazy stuff. And it's something that is very trivial to use. So these checks are super fast. But nowadays we have this thing called pieces engines, which are very cool. These engines provide like a mapping between the or virtual or game entity world and another virtual physics world. And if you look for games like Amiverse, they use a physics engine. So basically, using a physics engine means that you have things like okay, acceleration, bouncing, all these kind of physics properties like okay, actual mass of, you know, objects can fall, and you can have okay, you have been a platforming, you can do things like okay, jumping, collision between the platforms and so on. And these engines have been done by very smart people, a lot of them, they have been tested very well. And the most popular ones are free and open source. So there's no reason to code your own game engine unless you are really bored. You can make a game, you don't do an engine, you do a game. So Pixel has several built-in engines. The one that I use most of the time is this one for arcade. another one called P2. Arcade is very simple. It doesn't have many features, but the thing with this engine is super fast. It's faster than other P6 engines. And if you're doing like a simple game, maybe you don't want to actually do these equations manually, you can use this engine. It offers like collision with rectangles in bounding boxes, so you don't have complex shapes or whatever, but most of the time you don't need them. And you have things like, okay, acceleration, collisions between the game world and the characters, all like that. And if you need like more complex pieces, for instance, to boost a game like Antivers, you can use this other one called P2. So, the thing with this engine, I mean, you take a look at the documentation, it is super friendly, easy, intuitive. You can actually make the prototype for a game like Gunrivers in a weekend. The thing is like, okay, it is easy to use, but it's very hard to actually find the values that you want for your game. These are the numbers that will make your game fun or boring, or if your game has bugs or glitches or whatever. For instance, it's really common in game development when you're using a physics engine that you have an object that is moving really fast. It can actually go through objects that are not, you know, wide enough. So you need to actually tweak these values to actually not have glitches in your game. Another problem is that, okay, you can compute the gravity value or the mass of the object. So for instance, you play like a platform game, the worst thing that can happen is that your character kind of floats when it's jumping. So you need to actually tweak these values to make your game responsive, fun, and so on. So other things that you need to make a game. First, check it out, all the snippets that I have prepared. I mean, I have examples for most of the things that we have seen here, and more like particles. There's also like an asteroids implementation, so you could use some making a game, just check it out. These are some links. We have the Mozilla Developer Network, we have a game, portal, let's say. We have a lot of articles, tutorials with different game engines. We have 3DS tutorials, Phaser, programmers, and so on. There's also the Phaser forum that is very responsive, and the community is active. The actual creator is there, hanging out with people. The other thing is like the Ludum Dare, which is this competition, which I love. I mean, the cool thing about the game jams is that they only last a weekend. So you only need a weekend of your time to actually make a game. So this is actually my hidden purpose of this talk, is like, because games sometimes have this kind of like mystic aura around, because most people think, oh, games, super hard, super difficult. But we have the tech that we have nowadays allow us to create games from like in a really high level. So if you already know a bit of JavaScript, you can make a game. So you can take away like a weekend of your life, you can try make a game, which is something really cool. Let's say that you don't like games at all, but still, you need to read this article that is called One Game a Month, which is it describes like an iterative process to do prototyping. So regardless if you're doing games or web apps or whatever, it's actually a very cool article about agile development. And it's by one guy that did One Game a Month for a year. There is also like a more hardcore version that there was this woman, Denise, who is a mentor, and she did a game a week for a whole year, so 52 games in a year. So you can actually read the post-mortem of all of them, you know, their learning that she took, so that's really interesting. And the last one is Kama Sutra, which is the reference magazine, slash website, slash forum, whatever, in game development for decades. So everybody in the industry, you know, looks at this website, so for sticking up. Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, we don't have Q&A in this session, but I will be around at the bar. So I'm actually going to copy room. So if you have a question, you can buy me a telescope and I will be happy.